So we're here today to talk about sustainable aviation fuel, SAF, and what we're hearing about in the headlines today. So sustainable aviation fuel is a biofuel, right? It's made out of vegetable oils, canola, maybe ethanol one day.
Maybe a little soybean oil.
Maybe a little soybean oil.
Beef tallow.
Beef tallow, all these good things. So Dan, what do you think about SAF?
The conversation around SAF, from my perspective, is really being pushed at a federal level due to overall decarbonization goals that the federal government has set over the previous few years. The Biden administration a few years ago announced something called the SAF Grand Challenge, which is a challenge to producers to be able to bring in about 3 billion gallons of SAF into the market annually by 2030. So that is a pretty big goal. We're not developing much SAF these days. So in order to ramp up that production, the federal government has kicked in some federal incentives. Some states have some tax incentives, which we'll get into later. But airlines are also buying in. There's Delta, United, et cetera, are all saying that they want to purchase this fuel. They want to decarbonize their airplanes. And so that is where SAF is really getting a lot of attention these days.
It's getting a lot of attention, but we only make 100,000 gallons a year now, right?
That's less than 3 billion.
It's a lot less than 3 billion that we have to get to get the first goals. So,
absolutely. But we do have a long road ahead, right? It's a 24 billion gallon market, sustainable aviation.
It's a big market.
Jet fuel market in the U.S. So it's the birth of an industry.
Yes, it is.
Right, that we're watching. And so we have a lot of excitement right now. Why biofuel? Like, why should it be sustainable aviation fuel versus hydrogen versus electric? Do you guys have any thoughts on that?
I would just say that a straight drop-in type fuel is the best for multiple reasons. One is that batteries are really heavy. That would make decarbonizing the aviation sector via electrification incredibly difficult. You'd either have to have a lot less passengers on that plane, a lot less luggage. So if we can come up with a economical product that weighs the same as traditional jet fuel, that is a huge advantage as we're thinking about trying to decarbonize our aviation sector.
Yeah, having that drop-in fuel is important. Given the electrification, it's just a non-starter, basically.
Yeah, such a big deal. This hydrogen or electric, they just don't hold a lot of energy, right? Mm-hmm. So those wings need to hold all the energy to fly the plane, and they can't weigh millions and millions of tons, right? I think one of the reasons that the airline industry and the policymakers are excited about SAF is you can get to this 50% carbon intensity reduction, right? This is a big deal. And to get there, will the farmer have to do anything to make these fuels lower carbon? Is there something they can do to participate?
Yeah, definitely. In order to qualify for these tax credits that I mentioned earlier, you have to get to a 50 CI score for SAF. To measure that, we use what's called a GREET model, which is based out of one of our national laboratories. And a lot of smart people come together and try to figure out the overall life cycle carbon intensity of these fuels that we're producing. So according to the tax credits, you have to hit 50 on a carbon intensity score in this GREET modeling. Now, we just got a new GREET model that was released a couple of weeks ago that's specific to what's called a 40B tax credit, which is only in effect through the end of this year. But they did lay out a number of practices, farming practices, that farmers can utilize to decrease the carbon intensity of the corn they grow, soybeans they grow, for instance. And so we are reviewing those. We're trying to figure out the best ways for our farmers to be able to participate in that market, whether they're cover crops, no-till, et cetera. Enhanced fertilizers are another one that farmers can use to decrease their carbon scores. But the GREET model is really what drives the ability for farmers to be able to participate.
It's kind of like, you know, in the restaurant world, you hear a lot of farm to table, right? Well, in our world, it's starting to become field to engine, right? And the farmer, it starts with their practices, can actually lower the carbon. And to me, that's a big step change in how biofuels have worked in the United States before now. Yeah. And the Treasury, who is going to give us tax rebates, right, that is the big driver financially. That's what I've heard you guys say.
Yeah, and I would also just say probably the most abundant source of feedstock for sustainable aviation fuel right now is probably used cooking oil, getting to your restaurant reference. But we already import a lot of used cooking oil from other countries, China specifically. We're using used cooking oil for a number of other things. And so sooner or later, we have to get these additional feedstocks if we want to hit that 3 billion gallon goal by 2030.
I run the economic shop on the refining fuel side of the house, and what always comes to my mind is, where's the return on investment for people to get into this, right? If you have a plant, or like we have, where we have biofuels facilities where we make vegetable oils and ethanol, where's the return? Is there a return for us?
That's going to really start with the tax credit that I referenced. 40B right now is a tax credit up to $1.25 per gallon of SAF created. That helps decrease the overall cost that producers incur to create the fuel. Right now, it is not economical to produce SAF without these additional benefits from federal and state levels. So we have the 40B now. Next year, it rolls into what's called a 45Z clean fuel production tax credit. That's going to also offer a $1.25 tax credit with the options of boosting that higher with the lower score that comes with it. So we don't have guidance yet from the U.S. Treasury on 45Z yet, full guidance. However, we are, as Mike had referenced, working to help push them in a way that makes SAF more farmer friendly, makes it easier for our farmer owners to adopt some of these climate smart practices. Because again, without that additional help from governments, both at the federal and state level, it's just not economical. Airlines are not going to be paying double, triple what they're paying for traditional jet fuel right now. So to get that return on investment, one of the things you really need are those tax credits.
Right. And to go to that, you know, we talked about this being a very young industry that's just building out. And then you just talked about some of these tax credits, they only last for a few years, right? And and these are very expensive investments all along the supply chain, right? So is there a pace where this sustainable aviation fuel is just going to take over? It's going to take over all jet fuel. Is that something that's on the horizon?
I mean, Mike may have a better answer, but for me, I don't see it on the horizon. I think 3 billion gallons by 2030 is already quite aggressive. I think based on the 40B guidance, again, that we recently got, that won't allow for 3 billion gallons to be produced in 6 years. So that's why the upcoming guidance that we're waiting for is going to be incredibly important to the future of this industry. Are we going to allow for a menu of farming practices to be used? Are we going to allow, you know, co-processing at some facilities, whether it's a soybean oil, et cetera? All of these things need to be taken into account. On one hand, you want to decrease carbon as much as you can. On the other, we really need more gallons of SAF produced. So the federal government has its work cut out for it, and we'll see what they do in the 45Z guidance.
Certainly, it'll be difficult from the farmer's standpoint to understand all these regulations and how the technology works. We're learning at the plant level and at the farmer level, and trying to provide that education on how we can participate.
Yeah, and I would just add that CHS is uniquely positioned as both an ag and energy company to, for instance, provide inputs into new renewable fuel markets, as well as produce them. We aren't looking to produce, but we are still trying to learn how we may be able to play in some of these new markets. And we're going to continue advocating out in Washington and in state capitals for American agriculture to be able to have a seat at the table.
Excellent. Excellent. I mean, to me, this is like a fantastic way to wrap this up. CHS is focused on providing diesel detractors, right? We don't run airlines, but we are very, very interested in keeping pace with new technologies and getting pace of where the farmer can benefit from new demand pulls for their products. And we're going to monitor, and we're going to learn, and we're going to advocate. And for more, go to chsinc.com.